شهر الله شهر الله
شهر الله شهر الله شهر الله شهر الله رمضان شهر الرضوان والغفران
سورة فيل بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم ألم تر كيف فعل ربك بأصحاب الفيل ألم يجعل خيلهم في تضليل وأرسل عليهم طيرا وأبابيل ترميهم بحجارة من سجيل فجعلهم كأصف مأكول Salawat. I'm going to present the English now. In the name of Allah, the most beneficent and the most merciful, have you ever considered how your Lord dealt with the companions of the elephant? Did he not make their plan into a misguiding, and he sent against them birds in flocks, striking them with stones of hard clay, and he made them like eaten straw? Salawat.
Surah Al-Saff, Surah 61 of the Holy Quran. Surah Al-Saff is the third of the five Musabbahat surahs that begin by glorifying Allah. In Ayah 2, Allah addresses the believers. Ya ayyuhalladhina amanu, O you who believe, why do you say that which you do not do? Imam Ali has explained to us what belief, what iman means. He says that which you say with your tongue, that which you act with your body, and that which you believe in your heart, they should all line up. As believers, those who have iman, we must be careful that we don't say that which we don't act upon. We must be careful that our walk matches our talk. In Ayah 6 of this surah is the prediction that Prophet Isa alayhi salam gave to his people about the coming of a messenger after him who will be called Ahmed. And Allah fulfilled this promise nearly 600 years later with the coming of the final messenger, the Holy Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi. Allah in this verse addresses the Bani Israel. Who are the children of Israel? Let's go back to Prophet Ibrahim. He had two sons, Ismail and Ishaq. From Prophet Ismail, we have the Holy Prophet. And from Prophet Ishaq, he had a son called Yaqub. Prophet Yaqub is also known as Israel, a servant of God. Prophet Yaqub had 12 sons, and from him we have all the prophets. The children of Prophet Yaqub became known as the children of Israel, the Bani Israel. And you will find these mentioned throughout the Quran. In Ayah 14, Allah, again addressing the believers, tells us, Kunu Ansar Allah, be helpers of Allah. Allah is Al-Qadir, the most powerful. He doesn't need our help. He can do anything. And yet Allah is giving us the opportunity to be His Ansar, to help Him, to serve the creation. We're given the example of the disciples of Prophet Isa who fulfilled this role. And what an honor that we have to do the same. Let's go through the Quranic vocabulary. Ya ayyuhalladhina amanu. There are verses throughout the Quran that address those who believe. And we must be careful when we read these verses, what specific instructions is Allah giving to us? Bani Israel, the children, the descendants of Prophet Yaqub. An Ansar, helper, May Allah give us the opportunity to be Ansar Allah, to be helpers of Allah and serve the creation. Sadaqallahu al-Aliyyul Azim.
Assalamu alaikum. How are you all? I hope inshallah you're all well. So for today's discussion, I'd like to speak to you about signs from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and that they have been sent to guide us. So when I say the word sign, what comes to your mind? I wish I could speak to you, but I can't. But if you can, just speak to the person next to you and just share some ideas of what you think signs are, especially the younger ones. So say when we're traveling and we want to get to a destination. Obviously, nowadays we use this little device and say, okay, Google, take us to, for example, Clifton Road, and Google will take you there. But as drivers, we also need to pay attention to the road signs, the road markings, which will help us to get to where we need to go safely. So for example, if it's a 50 miles per hour road, I can't be doing 70 because there will be a sign telling me to do 50. And as a law-abiding citizen, that's what I should be doing. So in the same way, road signs are there to help us get to where we need to safely. Allah has also sent us signs to guide us. And he's done this through sending us signs through the Quran. There are signs all around us. There are signs sent during our lives as well. The word ayah in Arabic means sign, and it's been mentioned 85 times in the Holy Quran. Now, in order to help us understand this topic a little bit better, I think we should ask help from two little children, don't you? Should we ask Yasser and Zahra to help us? Yeah? Let's turn to page 83, chapter 14, and see if Yasser and Zahra can help us a little bit. Grandfather, Yasser and Zahra continued to walk along the path of the River Nile. Yasser kept wondering what happened to Prophet Musa after the miracle with the snake. Did Pharaoh give up and let Prophet Musa take Bani Israel out of Egypt? I don't think that Pharaoh would let Prophet Musa lead the Bani Israel away without more of a fight, he said out loud as they walked. You're right. Years passed by after what we just saw, Grandfather said. The people who followed Prophet Musa went through difficult times. Pharaoh threatened them and punish them in the worst ways possible. Allah was testing them. But sadly, even Prophet Musa's own people went against him. They began to doubt whether he would lead them out of Egypt after all. What happened then? Zahra asked, curious to know how Prophet Musa dealt with this rebellion from both his enemies and his followers. Allah sent signs to the people of Pharaoh, Grandfather replied. What kind of signs? More miracles? The Holy Quran began to shine as if in an answer to Zahra's question. Grandfather gently took the holy book from his pocket, kissed it gently, and handed it to Zahra. She was surprised, but she reached out to take it from Grandfather. Immediately, the Quran opened to Surah Al-A'raf, verse 133. What does it say? Asked Yasser. Zahra remembered that she was in wudu, so she placed her finger over the verse and began to recite. Although the verse was in Arabic, she found that she could understand its meaning. It says, so we sent upon them the storm and locusts and lice and frogs and blood as signs distinct from each other. Yet they showed arrogance and they were a guilty people. More animals mentioned in the Quran, said Yasser, his excitement muted when he heard the list. Are we going to see the locusts, lice, and frogs next? He asked in trepidation. Not today, Yasser, grandfather replied. Zahra looked up from the Quran in the dread. She and Yasser turned their eyes to the Nile and imagined how it would look with dark red waters and drooping reeds withering away along its banks. There was a famine and reduced harvest. Then, a few years later, the water in the Nile turned to blood. When the people didn't learn from all that, Allah finally sent the insects and swarms of locusts, lice and frogs, grandfather said with a solemn face. Zahra was confused. I thought signs were always good things that were supposed to lead you to Allah. Zahra, my dearest, Allah sent these misfortunes to guide the people to Him, to help them remember Him. Anything that reminds us of Allah is a sign from Him because it is pointing us in the right direction. This reminds me of coronavirus, Yasser said. So many people are suffering and it seems like a curse or a punishment of some sort. But what if we could learn from it and use it as an opportunity to get closer to Allah? Coronavirus? A way to get closer to Allah? Zahra asked. Yeah, Yasser nodded. Well, I see what you mean. We could look at it as a way of Allah calling us, reminding us that He is the most powerful and we need to turn back to Him. Grandfather looked from Yasser to Zahra. You're very right, he said. Everything that happens in our lives is an opportunity to get closer to Allah. It's easy to be thankful to Him in times of happiness and remember that everything comes from Him. We also need to return to Him in times of sadness and uncertainty, knowing that He is our only protector and hope for help. What words of wisdom from grandfather. Don't you agree? These people that Zahra was read about in Surah Al-A'raf that were so stubborn that despite all the troubles they faced, still refused to be guided to the truth. How do you think this happens? How does one become so blind to the truth? Well, you know when you do something wrong, we have an inner conscience that says, don't do that. Have you ever heard that little voice inside you? For example, before bed, mom asks you, go and brush your teeth. Have you brushed your teeth yet? And you're like, yeah. Because, you know, it's the end of the day. It's a bit of a task to brush your teeth when you're little. You don't really want to do it. So it's just easier to say you have. And then that inner voice tells you, Mahdi, go and tell mama that you haven't brushed and go and brush. Yeah? Or if you haven't prayed namaz. And, you know, you've come back from school, you're knackered. You know, there's a few minutes left till it's qaza. In the winter time, and you're like, oh, I really don't want to pray. And dad asks you, you've prayed, right? And you're like, yeah, I've prayed. And then you hear that little voice telling you, you haven't prayed. And you're lying as well. Go and do the right thing. Say you haven't and go and pray. That is your conscience. But now, if you stop listening to that conscience or you just ignore it, slowly, slowly, your heart starts to darken. And when that happens, you stop following the path that leads you to Allah. You actually move away from it. you get blinded to the signs that he sends, and you don't want to hear them, you don't want to listen to them, you don't want to, you just want to ignore them. And that's not a very nice path to go down. So whenever Allah sends you the signs, you won't be able to see them. But despite all of this, Allah is so Rahman, He's so Rahim. He says, please ask for forgiveness and I will guide you again. Something so simple as just asking for forgiveness sincerely. Say Astaghfirullah, promise not to do that bad deed again, and you will go closer to Him. For the older ones, you know, you can fast as well. That has some amazing benefits. It cleanses your soul. It makes you closer to Allah. Doing good deeds is another really easy one to do. Constantly surround yourself with positive thoughts. You will do positive things. You will do more good deeds. And all these will drive us closer to Allah. In fact, in this beautiful surah, Allah has also given us a lovely dua to recite from Surah Al-A'raf. Our Lord, we have wronged ourselves, and if you do not forgive us and have mercy upon us, we will surely be amongst the losers. It's a lovely dua to recite in your kunut, in your daily namaz. Surah Al-A'raf talks about communities before us who rejected their prophet, but focuses on Prophet Musa. And we all know about the miracle of Prophet Musa, where he turned this stick into a snake. But what other signs can we see now around us that tell us about Allah's existence? Let's think about the sun and the moon. What if they didn't exist? Did you know if the sun didn't exist, the earth's temperature would drop to 0 degrees and go further lower and lower in a matter of a few days to a few weeks? Without the sun's rays, plants will die because they rely on the sun for photosynthesis in order to grow. As a result, the animals and the humans who then rely on those plants for food could die too. This would cause other effects in the food chain, leading to us totally being wiped out of this earth. Life without the sun would be really difficult, and it would almost be impossible. Without the moon at night, there'll be no light. How would we go about if there was no lamp posts and, you know, lights around the road and stuff? It would be very, very dark. Now that spring is here, we will soon start to hear the buzzing of the bees. These little insects are so, so important in the food chain. Honeybees are extremely important pollinators of about 75% of the crops that feed the world. Did you know that? Subhanallah, have we ever thought about how beautifully Allah has orchestrated this whole process? Without these bees, we may lose all the plants that they pollinate, all of the animals that eat those plants, and ultimately ourselves. This means a world without bees could struggle to support and feed us all. Our supermarkets would literally have half the amount of fruit and veg, and this could mean a world without carrots, apples, lemons, onions, Brazil nuts, and of course, our sweetest honey. Can you imagine such a world? These are just some of the signs we can see around us that help us to understand that there is some greater power who has created and is in control of all these things. I mean, think about the solar system. Look at the sun. Look at the size of the sun compared to the earth. It's marvelous. I mean, when we light a fire, you know, to roast our marshmallows or whatever, it fizzles out after a while, right? Yet, How is the sun, which is a great ball of fire created 4.5 billion years ago, still burning? I mean, it is amazing. Who besides Allah can create something so spectacular and amazing? And it's just so precise. Everything's working in sync. The most fitting ayah for such a thing is فَبِأَيِّ عَلَىٰ إِرَبِّكُمَا تُكَذِّبَانِ. Then which of the favors of your Lord will you deny? It just goes to show that there is a greater power who has created all of this and is in control of it all. From our glorious Quran and the example of the Bani Israel I mentioned earlier, we know that Allah sends us signs sometimes when He feels we're kind of moving away from the path He has bestowed upon us. He only does this to grab our attention and remind us. He's actually trying to say, hello, my people, please wake up. You're going into the darkness. Come back, come back. I'm here for you. He does this because He loves us so much. And you know what? Everyone is tested in this life. Everyone, every one of us will go through a test in some way or another. But it's important to remember Allah will only test you in a way that you can handle. He knows us better than we know ourselves. He will never give you something you won't be able to handle. And that's why we must always remember Him, also when we're going through a difficult time. Yeah? I mean, think about it. If you wanted to become a footballer when you grow up, and if you always played against the okay-ish teams, would you really become better? Would your skills really grow? No, they wouldn't. But if you played a team that was top of the league, you know, you would be really putting your skills to test. You would then know what position you play best. You'd know what you're good at, what you need to work on, and then you can grow your skills and become a better footballer. You win some matches, you lose some, but that's how you become better. For your 11 plus exams as well, you know, you've studied really hard and everybody studied differently, but what if all of you studied at different levels, but all of you ended up getting into the same school? Would that be fair? No, it wouldn't. So that's why you get given a school that's for you, and Allah knows why that's come your way. You might not think you want to go there, but have faith in His decision. If it's an okay school, go with it. Allah knows what's best for you, and that's why He's given it to you. Have faith in that decision. There's something in there for you to grow. I mean, when we think about the pandemic at the moment, for example, this brings me to a very important question time. This is more for the older ones. Now, do you need to believe in Allah first in order to recognize the signs, or do the signs guide you to believe in Allah? It's a very, very good question to think about. Feel free to discuss it with your friends, with your family, and see what you come up with. And this also links in with a very important saying I've come across, which is, O Allah, surround me with those who remind me of You, who elevate my iman and will hold my hand all the way to Jannah. Now, I think growing up, friends are so important, so, so important. And you should always surround yourself with friends who will drive you closer to Allah. If they're driving you away from Him, then those are probably not the friends you should be around. Going speaking about the pandemic that Yasser was talking about in the book, I mean, when we think about our experiences so far, Mount was cancelled last year. You know, sports lovers were absolutely distraught. You know, grandparents suddenly became so lonely, we couldn't visit them. We weren't allowed birthday parties. We had to have birthday parties on our own. No friends, no relatives, probably just the odd driveway. And, you know, when you think about it that way, yes, it's really sad. And it makes people really unhappy. But for a moment, just close your eyes and think about the good things that have come from it. I mean, yes, some people, some families did lose loved ones, and it was really tragic. But our loved ones have gone back to our Creator, and we all have to go back to Him. At one point in our lives, we will all have to embark on the journey to the next world. Schools were closed, we were all at home, you all had to learn from home. You had a new skill to learn. I mean, you've become brilliant at computers. I know my kids are only 7 and 8, but they are absolute geniuses when it comes to Zoom and how to handle, you know, the computers. And they've taught me a thing or two. I mean, parents who can work from home have been at home. And kids, come on, tell me, hasn't it been amazing having your parents at home? There's been no rushing around in the morning for school. You can be in your pajamas. You can go out into the garden when you need a break or open the fridge when you like. You know, there's been no going for martial arts or swimming or sticking in traffic going for a football game. I mean, just tires me thinking about it. Gosh, how did we do it all? And I think perhaps Allah was trying to tell us, guys, please, just breathe, take some time out, talk to each other, spend time with each other, just slow down already. I mean, in this day and age, we're so into our technology and social media and video games and Instagram that we don't have time for each other. And this was probably a way to say, come on, guys, talk to each other now. Spend time together. Last Ramadan, there was no mosque, but it was so lovely having iftar together, wasn't it, with our families? We all made such an effort to be more in touch with each other, send food to each other, and, you know, keep in touch with relatives we haven't talked to, spoken to friends we don't normally talk to a lot. And, you know, these are all highly recommended in Islam. Some people have also discovered their creative side and opened up businesses during lockdown. How amazing is that? I know of a little girl who started a slime business just a few weeks ago. I mean, that's amazing. And another one who's written a book, one started baking. And, you know, they're all giving some of the money towards charity, and it's absolutely fantastic. And not going to work in school has actually had an amazing impact on the environment. I mean, there's been a 20 to 30% reduction in air pollution in major cities around the world. The quality of air has become better. There's bluer skies. You know, Mother Earth and animals and the insects are so happy right now. There's less people falling ill as well. And since we've had nowhere to go, we've discovered loads of new places to go for walks. We've discovered hiking sites. And, you know, we've all become healthier. Obviously, a few of us have put on a little bit of weight, but the exercise we've also started will help us lose that. I mean, when we sit and ponder over the pandemic, there are so many good things that have come of it. And inshallah, we'll be able to continue doing those things and lead better lives. Some of us have even learned to ride a bike. You know, Allah says in the Holy Quran in Surah Al-Baqarah, signs are clear for those who have certainty. Now let us all pray to Him to always guide us on the right path through His signs and remain devoted to Him. For today's activity, actually, I think it would be a great idea to make your own sign to remind you of Allah. There'll also be other age-specific activities that I believe have already been sent out to you or are on their way to you. So please feel free to do those. Thank you so much for listening. Wassalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.
Assalamu alaikum everybody, how are you? Okay, so today we are carrying on with Dua Iftita. This section is labelled 1.2 in your books. Well, for those of you who have got your Dua books anyway. Those of you that haven't, no worries, just listen in. Okay, so in line 3 to 8, Allah is described as the most merciful and also the most severe. Now, those are antonyms of each other, aren't they? So it's a little bit strange. Let's have a look to see if we can work out what's going on. So, we know that Allah is so super kind. And He always wants us to do good. He gives us loads and loads and loads of opportunities to ask for forgiveness. But when we keep breaking the rules from our manual, the Quran, and we don't ask for forgiveness, there needs to be consequences. Let's think of an example. Your parents love you the most in the whole wide world. Now, they always want the best for you and they want you to be the best version of yourselves. But sometimes they can seem really strict. They always want you to go to bed at the right time. They always want you to eat properly. They always want you to do your homework. They always decide if you're allowed to eat things from certain places and not eat things from certain places. Why do they do this? It's because they know what's good for you and they only want the best for you. Now, another example for consequences is at school. Now, if you break the rules, then what happens? You can lose your break, can't you? You're not allowed to go out at playtime. Now, they've already given you the classroom rules or the behaviour code, and that tells us, well, that tells you what you can do and what you can't do. And if you break them, these rules, again and again, there will be consequences, won't they? Everybody's seen this at school. So Allah has given us the guidelines, He's given us the Quran, He's given us the Quran, which is also called the Furqan. Remember we talked about what this means. Okay, let's have a look at line 21, 22 and 23. Now, what blessings are there that we can think of? We really can't count all of them. We really can't, seriously. If you try and think of all of Allah's blessings, you actually can't count them. Trust me, I tried. So, I started off by thanking Allah for the fact that I could talk. And then I remembered that I had to thank Allah for my tongue. And then I had to thank Allah for my lips. And then I had to thank Allah for the bit in my throat that made me talk. But I've already mentioned this one of the other days, won't I? So let's talk about something else. It's still true that I have to thank all my blessings for when I'm talking. But what about when I'm listening? I have to thank Allah that sound can travel through the air. Then I have to thank Allah that the sound can go into my ear and that I have an ear. And that the sound can go inside my ear and somehow go along some special nerve things to my brain. And then my brain be able to work out what it means. Oh, and I need to thank Allah for my nerves, and I need to thank Allah for my brain, and then I need to thank Allah for the fact that my brain knows what to do, and the fact that there's language, and the fact that I know that language, well, what the language means, and then the fact that I can interpret the words into what they mean, and then I can understand it. So I need to thank Allah for the brain part that I can understand. Oh, and I also need to thank Allah for the bits that I'm listening to. This is hard work. This goes on and on and on and on and on. Seriously, There are so many blessings and so many favours that Allah has given us. We literally can't thank Allah for all of them. But we really should thank Allah as much as we can. And it's actually a fun game to thank Allah for, try and thank Allah for all of the things. And it's just amazing. You just realise actually how much Allah has given us. Alhamdulillah, He is too kind. Okay, let's have a look at lines 74 to 77. Here, it says that Allah has patience despite His knowledge and forgiveness and a lengthy respite. Now, patience despite knowledge. Have you ever tried to teach something to a younger person, like a little brother or a little sister or a little cousin or a little friend? It's a bit difficult, isn't it? Because you really know what they need to do. And sometimes it just takes them ages and ages and ages and ages to get it. And you kind of really just want to jump in and do it for them. And if, especially if they're doing it wrong. But imagine Allah knows everything and He's really patient with us. He forgives us and He gives us such a long time to actually ask for forgiveness. He gives us the whole day. We can wait, and if we don't thank, and we can thank Him, if we don't ask for forgiveness straight away, we can ask for forgiveness before we go to bed, and inshallah, Allah will forgive our sins. We really, really, really should always make sure that we do that. Okay, let's have a look at lines 100 to 103. Now it says here that Allah's curtains can never be opened. What does that mean? I had to do quite a bit of thinking about this, and I worked out by asking some very clever people who are way cleverer than me, and I found out that this means that we can never see Allah. No matter how much we want to, we can't see Him. But the thing is, the next line is really clever and really important, and it says that His doors will never be locked or never be closed. And that means that even though we can't see Him, He is always, always there for us. We never need to feel like we're on our own. We never need to feel like we're lost or lonely, because Allah is always, always, always there. That made me feel really nice and warm and fuzzy on the inside. I really like that bit. Okay, so between lines 104 to 115, the Imam lists 12 groups of people. Now, the question in the book asks you to add some ticks and crosses, and I'm sure you can do that bit yourself, because remember, you guys are a smart bunch. But let's have a careful look at a couple of these. In line 110, Imam praises Allah who annihilates the oppressors. Annihilates means completely destroys. And the oppressors means people who are doing things that are not fair. Now, I really, really hope that none of us are oppressors. What does it mean to be an oppressor? So an oppressor is somebody who, as we said, is unfair. So it could be being unfair or mean to somebody, but it can also be oppressing parts of yourself. Now, this is a really, really, really interesting idea. Now, every part of us has a right because it was made by Allah for good. And by using it for something that's wrong, we're being unfair to it. So, for example, if we listen to some music, we are using our ears in an unfair way. So we are oppressing our ears. It's true. If we talk about somebody in a way that they wouldn't like, so we backbite or use or do ghiba, we are basically using our tongue and our mouth, which was created for good, in a way that's wrong, and we're oppressing it. So We have to be really careful that we ourselves are not oppressors, because that would be terrible, because we don't want Allah to annihilate us, do we? Now, another point in the dua, Allah tells us, an imam tells us, that Allah helps those who need help. Now, when Allah does this, sometimes he helps people through other people, kind of like when people are being kind to each other. So, for example, if Allah needs people to, well, doesn't need people, but chooses people to help other people, then we want to be the people that he chooses, don't we? So, for example, if somebody ever asks you for help, it's really important that we should help them. And sometimes people don't ask for help, but we should be really careful, and we should look out, and we should see that if anybody looks like they need help, that we should go and help them, especially at home, like our mums and our dads. We should really, really, really make a big effort to go and help them. Now, what I want you to do is, this is the end of this section that we're going to talk about. But what I would like you to do is, I'd like you to have a look at the next section in the book and complete the activities. If you don't have the book, again, that's absolutely fine. Okay, take care. See you soon. Khudafiz.
اللهم صل على محمد وآل محمد السلام عليك يا رسول الله السلام عليك يا نبي الله السلام عليك يا أمير المؤمنين يا علي بن أبي طالب السلام عليك يا فاطمة زهرة سيدتي نساء العالمين السلام عليك يا حسن بن علي المجتبى رحمة الله وبركاته السلام عليك يا أبا عبد الله وعلى الأرواح التي حلت بفنائك عليك مني جميع سلام الله أبدا ما بقيت وبقي الليل والنهار ولا جعله الله آخر الأهد مني لزيارتكم السلام على الحسين وعلى علي بن الحسين وعلى أولاد الحسين وعلى أصحاب الحسين ورحمة الله وبركاته السلام عليك يا علي بن الحسين زين العابدين السلام عليك يا محمد بن علي الماقد السلام عليك يا جعفر بن محمد الصادق السلام عليك يا موسى بن جعفر القاذب السلام عليك يا غريب الغربة وبعيد المدى السلطان أبا الحسن مولانا علي بن موسى الرضا كن شفيعنا وشفيع والدينا في يوم الجزاء رحمة الله وبركاته السلام عليك يا محمد بن علي الجواد السلام عليك يا علي بن محمد الهادي السلام عليك يا حسن بن علي أيها الزكي الأسكري ورحمة الله وبركاته السلام عليك يا مولانا يا صاحب الأصل والزمان الأمان 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 من فتنة الزمان السلام عليك يا خليفة الرحمن السلام عليك يا شريك القرآن السلام عليك يا كعبة الإيمان السلام عليك يا إمام الإنس والجان متى ترين نرى أجل الله لك ما وعدك من نصر ودخول الأمن ورحمة الله وبركاته
أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم اللهم كل وليك حجت ابن الحسن صلواتك عليه وعلى آبائه في حد شرطي وفي كل شهر وليا وحافظا والقائد وناصرا ودليا وعينا حتى تسكنه أرضك ضوءا وتمطيه فيها طويلا برحمتك يا أرحم الراحمين.
شهر رمضان الذي